Well, let's just sit down for a moment. Somebody might remind you of some of the announcements you might have missed in the video.
From 5 to 6. And what that phone-a-thon is for us to kind of reconnect with our members. Members that we haven't seen in a while, friends that haven't joined us in a while. And so I would invite any of you that can come to come and help us make all those phone calls. And it's about reconnection, right? It's about restoration of our family. There's so many people that I've come to love in this church, and I don't see them every week. So let's see what we can do to kind of rebuild our family. And along those lines, I know it's been a long week. Some of us haven't seen each other since last Sabbath. And so let's take a couple minutes to greet each other, bring that love and that joy and that peace of Jesus that's way down deep in your heart. Bring it up to the surface now and reconnect with our family and friends here. Let's take a couple minutes to do that, okay?
Okay, we have a surprise for you, but we need you to hurry back to your seat. The pastor that's preaching today needs a lot of time, so all this adds on to the end. Our surprise, right here, here it is. Catch it.
Happy Sabbath, everybody.
We're playing a video again.
Welcome to the Seventh-day Adventist Church. We welcome you to worship with us today.
If you are interested in football, and especially if you're rooting against the Rams, sorry, Phil, on February 13th, that's this Sunday at 3 o'clock, we are having a Super Bowl party in the Vine Center. Bring something to share, a food, snack, whatever your favorite Super Bowl snack. Bring it, and we're going to have a wonderful time celebrating fellowship and football. We are reaching out to all of our church members, whether they have been here in the last 2 years or if we haven't seen them in the last 20 years. We've got a huge list of church members. We want to reconnect with them. To do that, we are starting with a member phone-a-thon. We're going to be gathering on Thursday evenings through the rest of February from 5 o'clock to 6:30. And we have a list of names and phone numbers of church members that we're going to be reaching out to. We would love if you would help us reconnect with our church family. If you're interested and want to sign up, volunteer, talk with Keith Francis or myself or even Debbie Smith about the possibility. Do you like to sew? If so, talk to Sarah Smith or to Marge Nakamura. They are going to be sewing on Sunday, February 20th at 2:15 p.m. in the Rose Room. If you'd like to join them, reach out. You can either even talk to myself or Keith Francis. Finally, Rio Lindo Adventist Academy is going to be having an Academy Day on Sunday, February 27th from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. All 7th through 10th graders are invited to visit classes, meet teachers, play games, tour the dorms, win prizes, and more. Everyone who attends will get a free swag bag and a $300 discount on tuition. We hope that your time here with our church family feels like time with your family. Let us surround one another with some small part of the warmth and love that Christ has for us.
Did you get it this time? Because we could play it again. Not yet. Is that the one? People were bringing their little children to Jesus for him to place his hands on them. But the disciples rebuked them. When Jesus saw this, he was indignant. He said to them, "Let the little children come to me and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of God belongs to such as these. Truly I tell you, anyone who will not receive the kingdom of God like a little child will never enter it." And he took the children in his arms, placed his hands on them, and blessed them. Let's stand up again. But we're going to play a slow song.
Not slow.
I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river in my soul. And I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got love like an ocean in my soul. I've got joy like a fountain. I've got joy like a fountain. I've got joy like a fountain in my soul. I've got joy like a fountain. I've got joy like a fountain. I've got joy like a fountain. I've got peace like a river. I've got love like the ocean. I've got joy like a fountain in my soul. I've got peace like a river. I've got love like the ocean. I've got joy like a fountain in my soul.
I know more people know those hand signals. I saw a few of you doing them. Yay for you.
Through the praise of children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies to silence the foe and the avenger.
Where are the lights? Get your lights up. Come on, everybody.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. And this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Hide it under the bushel, no, I'm gonna let it shine. Hide it under the bushel, no, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Won't let Satan blow it out, and I'm gonna let it shine. Won't let Satan blow it out, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. All around the I'm gonna let it shine. All around the neighborhood, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Let it shine till Jesus comes. I'm gonna let it shine. And let it shine till Jesus comes. I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. This little light of mine, yes, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Wondering why we're doing all these easy, simple songs? Sometimes we make things way more complicated than they need to be. Love Jesus, love others, love yourself.
Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me, this I know, as he loved so long ago, taking children on his knee, saying, let them come to me. Yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me. Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me still today, walking with me on my way, wanting as a friend to give light and love to all who live. Yes, Jesus loves me, yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me, the Bible tells me so. Jesus loves me, he who died, heaven's gate to open wide. He will wash away my sin, let his Jesus loves me.
Oh yes,
Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so.
You can be seated, I think.
Scripture reading today comes from the first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 15, verses 1 to 2. 1 Corinthians 15, 1 to 2, and I shall read from the New International Version. Now, brothers, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel, you are saved, if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise, you believe. I'm going to invite you to take a posture of prayer at the moment. If that means kneeling, please kneel. If that's standing, stand. Bowing your heads. Let's come before God as a congregation in prayer. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that we have the privilege of being your children. We thank you for the gospel which makes this possible. We thank you that you are our Father and that you are our God. You are worthy of worship, and we worship you now in our songs, in our prayers, in our study, in our listening. We thank you that we can indeed worship you at this time. Guide our worship. Be with us in our worship. Give us the energy and the strength to worship you anew and with vigor. We thank you for this day of worship. We thank you for the Sabbath day, for marking for us a day to recognize your ownership of us. We thank you for the rest and relaxation of this Sabbath day. We thank you for the honor of being able to praise you on this day. As a church, we pray for ourselves. We are embarking on several new ministries. You know them all, Lord. But of course, we give thanks and praise for Pastor Elaine, who will be with us physically from tomorrow. We thank you that this has been an answer to a long, month-long prayer. We thank you for her ministry that will occur in the future, and we thank you for the strong leadership of Pastor Brett. You know the needs of this church, Lord. You know the burdens that will be borne by the pastoral staff. But you also have promised to lead us on and to lead us forward. And we thank you for this promise. We pray for ourselves individually at this time, Lord, as a congregation. We pray for understanding, as Pastor Harold leads us in understanding your word. We pray for insight to see the gospel anew. We pray for energy to carry out the task that you have for us. And also we pray for our role in the community of Santa Rosa. You know we want to be a witness to the community. You know we want to be a light to the community. Give us the grace and give us the strength to be those witnesses, to be the people who people ask questions about, who people want to know about Jesus because of us. We thank you that you can do this in us. And finally, Lord, we pray for those who cannot be with us physically today. You know the various reasons. Bind them to us through our worship, through your Holy Spirit. We thank you that that Holy Spirit promise is with us now, will be with us tomorrow, and will be with us forevermore. We thank you in the name of Jesus our Savior. Amen.
Hello. Perfect. I feel like I'm being interviewed over an international incident. All right. Which one should I go with? All right, we're going to stick with it. Wonderful. The second thing I want to just call to your attention is some of you know and have seen that here in Sonoma County, the mask mandate is going to be lapsing on Wednesday. We've been praying about this. We've been thinking about this. One of the things that we are taking into consideration is the fact that there are parts of our congregation who will not be able to come to church without a mask. And so our thought is we're going to move as a church family on this. And so we're strongly encouraging a mask here at church. And we will continue to monitor that. And when we can go mask-free as a family, we will do that. And that's where we're at today. Come and talk to me if you have any questions. I'd love to hear what you have to say. I also want to invite Fred and Sally Rudell to stand up. They don't know that I'm doing this, which is part of my fun. Some of you, and many of you know, we have been thanking Keith, and you have seen Keith Francis all over the church cleaning up. But what you might not know is that Fred and Sally have been alongside Keith every step of the day. It seems like every day of the week they are here selflessly investing their time and energy into making our church the most pleasant and lovely place that it can be. And so I just want to take a moment of appreciation to Fred and Sally for all that you do. Thank you guys so much. Hello. Hello. Oh. All right, it is now time for our offering call. I am in the book Luke chapter 16. One who is faithful in a very little is also faithful in much. And one who is dishonest in a very little is also dishonest in much. If then you have not been faithful in unrighteous wealth, who will entrust to you true riches? And if you have not been faithful in what is another's, who will give you that which is your own? No servant can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or he will be devoted to one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and money. Now, it's easy to read that passage and think, ooh, that sounds threatening. But I would actually suggest to you that it is not a threat, but rather to see this as an opportunity. Jesus is saying that God has given us the means that he has so that we have something small, like finances, to demonstrate faithfulness with. so that he can trust us with the things that are even more profoundly important to him and his kingdom. In effect, giving is the way that God is trying to set us up for something greater in his service. And so please consider giving first and foremost, not as financial support for a church or an institution, but rather as an opportunity to deepen our connection with Christ and open up the door he wants to give us to do something great in and through our lives. The deacons will be picking up the offering while the children's story is going on. And so I want to invite our kids to come up. I have a special story for you today. While you do, if you've got cash that you'd like to give to our children's programming here at the Santa Rosa Church, the young ones are going to be collecting that before the deacons collect your regular tithes and offerings.
The word gospel.
All right.
Come on up. Come on up.
Well, welcome. We are so glad that you guys are here, and it looks like there are a few more filtering. Come on up.
Yeah, you, dude. Come on.
All right. Some of you know that my family has two massive... Oh, hey, Emily. I haven't seen you in a little while. Good to see you. Some of you know that my family has two massive dogs that are part of our family. They're Chocolate Labs, Bear, and Shepherd. Shepherd is like 120 pounds, and Bear is a svelte, about 100 pounds. And part of the reason that they have become so humongous is they are incredibly dependable in one very important way. During mealtimes at the Ginger household, they sit right next to the dinner table, and the moment any food should out to the floor or should even get close to falling to the floor, like it lands on a chair or else, testing, all right, or anything else, they leap into action and okay, and grab anything that falls to the floor. And they've gotten very good at it to the point that sometimes they don't even wait until something hits the floor before they take it. If you're eating an apple and your hand goes below the level of the table, they will grab it. If your toast is sitting unattended near the edge of the table, they're after it. So much so that we actually had to put up some baby gates so that they could not get next to the dining table while we were eating. Thanks, Larry. And now they sit patiently right behind that baby gate, ready, watching, oh, so rapturously watching, as each calculating in their minds, oh, there's lots of spaghetti over there. Oh, there's a pea I saw over there. And as soon as we open up that baby gate, they are there to clean up our mess. Jesus, in some ways, is like my dog's barren shepherd. He is waiting at the door to our lives. And when we make messes, sometimes in church we call that sin. Jesus is ready. And if we are willing to just open up to him, he will jump into action and clean us right up. Isn't it amazing that Jesus is willing to do that for you and for me? What a good Savior we have in Jesus.
Move on, see if now my controller works. I'm not sure. The what? It's muted, so we should be good. All right. It's all good. Technology sometimes. Let's pray, because today, regardless, we're going to make much of Jesus Christ. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, I pray for your Holy Spirit. Guide my thoughts and my words, but also open our hearts and minds as we continue to understand
greatest news ever. For I pray in your name. Amen. 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 While they figure things out on the back, in case my slides don't work, I'll just continue preaching. But I remember Raymond told me with tears in his eyes. It was very emotional. As a matter of fact, he was trembling when he was telling me this story. The story took place in the 1980s. In the country where I was born in Nicaragua, Central America, and there was a civil war. And I remember him telling me that they had been walking for days. He was just a teenager. And they had been walking on the wet mountains. It was the rainy season. And they had been walking for days, he told me. And they were tired. They were frustrated. They were hungry. As a matter of fact, he told me that they were walking in so much mud that for many of the soldiers in his company, the boots were stuck to their skin, you know. And I remember him telling me as he cried and trembled and told me this story that, you know, they've been just eating whatever they found because they ran out of food. And they told me they ate green bananas when they would find them in the mountains. And at some point, their faces lit up when they came into a valley. And in the middle of the valley, there was this little hut, this little house with some cows around and some goats and whatever and chicken. And they're like, food, right? And so their leader went down with some escort, and they talk with the family there and say, we're here on behalf of the government. The government will pay you back, but the soldiers are starving. And we're going to take your cows and whatever to feed the troops. Raymond was there not because he wanted to. He was drafted against his will when he went out and with an AK-47 on his head, they took him. As a matter of fact, even kids were drafted into this war. It was terrible. And he's telling me all of this story, and he's like, man, regardless how I got there, we were starving, and we went down there, and it was barbecue time, man. We forgot. We just ate. We ate tortillas, and, you know, they killed the cows, and we're eating, and, you know. And they forgot that they were in the middle of a war. You know, as they were feasting, because they were starving and tired, Raymond told me that without them knowing, this was all a setup. And while they were feasting down there in the middle of the valley, they were being surrounded by about 2,000 men. With one of the fiercest leaders of the Contras, remember the Iran-Contra deal back? Well, the Contras, one of the fiercest, Mike Lima, his troop, were surrounding them, and all of a sudden, without them realizing them, bullets were raining all over them. And while he was trembling and telling me, because most of his company was made up of teenagers that grew together, friends from the neighborhood, he started naming as they were caught in surprise as he saw his friends just fall to the ground. And at some point, he got hit, right? And he told me, man, I got hit by a bullet, and all I could feel was fire going in my leg and pain, and I fell down, and I was horrified because I was feeling water all over, and it was pools of blood. And he's telling me all of this, and he's telling me while I was there, and when I saw that I had the blood of my friends in my hands, I was, my whole life flashed in my mind, Herald, and I was there, and I kept everywhere I looked, everybody was dead, and right there in the middle of the pool of blood, I prayed to God. I was like, God, I think this is it for me. But perhaps if you could rescue me, do so. You know, when I thought of today's message, I thought of this story that Raymond told me. And I kept thinking, man, that's like our situation here. It's like, you know, we're in the middle of this mess sometimes, it feels like it, right? And there's so much pain and suffering. And for many people, perhaps somebody who's watching from home today or in the future, or any one of you here, it feels like you're trapped. It feels like you're surrounded. It feels like there's no way out. What has God to do when he finds a world filled with sin and pain and suffering? This is where the gospel comes in. God himself has come to rescue and renew all creation through the work of whom? Of Jesus Christ. And that's the motivation that Pastor Brad, when we discussed the series, had, you know, and it's the understanding that whenever we become gospel fluent, that whenever the gospel becomes part of us, whenever the gospel invades our hearts and our minds, and it's not just information, but we understand that relationship, right? Whenever we have that full understanding, like he well stated last week in his sermon, right? That funny illustration at the beginning of Lost in Translation, right? But whenever we understand that, whenever the message is not lost in translation, and we fully understanding, it just leads to a changed life. You see, many people start from the opposite. They start outside in, but in the Bible, it's all about the inside out life. So, just to summarize, we are reviewing four declarations of the gospel. Right? And I hope that you hang with us, because these are the declarations, these are statements, and then we're going to cover the four responses to the gospel. We already covered the kingdom has come. Pastor Brad preached about Jesus is the Christ, the anointed one, the king that was to come. And today, we're preaching the third declaration. Jesus died for our sins. So let's get going. 1 Corinthians 15. Now, brothers and sisters, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel, look at this. By this gospel, what? He says, you have been saved. Okay, this is so important. By this gospel, you have been saved. If you hold firmly to the word I preached to you, otherwise you have believed in vain. Right? This is so important. Like, how are we saved? What is the key for salvation? It is all in the gospel, in the greatest news ever. And then he continued, for what I received, I pass on to you as of first importance. As of first importance. That what he says? That Christ died for what? For our sins, according to scriptures. And I know this is where we find things offensive, right? Sin is not a sexy word. Right? Sin is not a sexy word, and I want to talk about it right quick. Because when, you know, nowadays you tell somebody you're a sinner, what? You know, people might not understand that word. You know, especially when it's talking about me. We rather think in terms of, oh, I'm a mistaker. I just made a mistake. You know, we all make mistakes. Oh, it's not that superficial. It's deeper than that. It's just hard to admit it. You know what? Whenever you cheated on your wife, and you took the time to pick up a phone, research a phone number and an address to set up an appointment, that's not a mistake.
That's a well-planned out sinful action. Not just a mistake in the spur of the moment, right? We are sinful beings. Mistakes, but the reality is that there's a deeper issue that we cannot just skirt around. All of us are sinners, the Bible states. And it's hard to recognize that. It is easier to point the finger. Look, that person is a sinner. That person is doing that. It's hard to say, I am a sinner. It's hard to deal with my stuff. Bible says in 1 Timothy 1:15, Christ Jesus came into the world to what? Save sinners, of whom, Paul says, I am the what? Chief. See, that is a correct understanding, a correct position of saying, like, I'm the boss of all sinners. Like, if they were to give a price in heaven about the number one position of sinners, I get it. Right? Paul is saying that, man, and I want to be like Paul sometimes. I admire Paul, and he's saying, I am the chief of sinners. This is the very reason why Jesus came, he says. Right? So it is important for us to be in a right position to be saved by Jesus. We got to kind of own that. Like, I'm a sinner. It is beyond just me making mistakes. Like, I hurt people and I hurt myself. That's, sin is that. Sin is hurting others and hurting myself. And that's why God hates sin, because sin hates others and hurts us. So that's why Jesus and God hates sin so much. But how do we come to this? Just a quick review. God created a perfect world, and it was just incredible, a paradise, right? Humans were healthy, and they were, perfect, created, no sin around, and it was just incredible. It was an incredible dream. It is actually the desire. All of us, every human has a sense of loss, a sense of something is missing in this world, right? As a chaplain, I hold the hands of people when they're dying, or when people are telling them, hey, you're going to die, or when people are in the hospital, still not feeling well, perhaps they're not going to die. But in those moments, people talk about these things all the time. The ultimate questions of life come to mind whenever you're coming face to face with the reality that you're not an eternal being, that we're very weak humans. As humans, we're one breath away from dying. And all of us, in one way or another, people express the desire, the wish, the dream that perhaps something was different, that perhaps there was no need to die, that perhaps there was no need to suffer, because we want that lost paradise. God created everything perfect. But then, as we know, sin came into the world, knocking, and this world opened the door, and sin came about. Soon enough, the first fight, marriage fight, Adam and Eve going at it. No, the woman that you gave me. And then the woman is like, no, that serpent that you made. And then they were naked and they were afraid, and shame came in and guilt came into the picture. And from there on, we've been dealing with the consequences of sin, pain and suffering, humans hurting other humans, us hurting ourselves, and that's a crazy cycle, right? As a matter of fact, the Bible continues and says in Romans 7, we know that the law is spiritual, but I am unspiritual, sold a slave to sin. I do not understand what I do, for what I want to do, I do not do, but what I hate, I do. It is the predicament that you and I find ourselves in, right? Like, I want to be the best dad ever, but if you were to interview my daughters, they will tell you that I'm a mess, that I need help by Jesus, right? Like, if you ask my wife, I aim, I want, I pray, I desire to be the bestest. I know that's not a word. It should be. bestest husband ever, but the reality is that I am not. I want to be. But there's this fight in our hearts. Like a Christian, I want to be the bestest, most obedient, most awesome, most always in awe of Jesus, worshiping Christian guy that loves others, even ahead of myself. But the reality that that doesn't happen all the time, right? So we find ourselves in this middle ground, in this, fight, if you will. And we come to the reality face to face that, hey, I am a sinner. There's something not right in the human heart. It is deeper than just mistakes. It is something that the Bible calls sin. But the things that come out of a person's mouth, the Bible says, come from where? From the heart. And this defiles them. For out of the heart come what? Evil thoughts, murder, adultery, sexual immorality, theft, false testimony. I don't cheat on my wife, and I don't steal anything. But that person over there, we start slandering others. We start, right? Bible says, out of the heart, all of these things which are meant to hurt others. That's why Jesus said, whenever you do it to one of these little children, you do it unto me. It's like, you know, it's deeper sin. So here comes the big question. How do we fix this? How do we fix it? Because now we're in this tension, in this position, I'm like, everything is broken. Things, it seems, you know, it just takes like a minute on Facebook scrolling around for you to know how messed up we are as humans. And that is true in churches and outside of churches, by the way. At some point as a pastor, I said, you know what, I had it. There is so much drama, so much pain, so much slander, so much whatever in this church. I'm trying to find community outside of church. It might be that the people outside of church are right, that Christians are just messed up, hypocrites, whatever. So I started looking around. I'm a runner, even though I'm not super skinny, and people look at me weird when I tell them I'm a runner. I am. Okay, I just eat probably tacos, the same amount of tacos as the miles that I run, and that's my problem. So I run to eat, pretty much. But I'm a good runner, okay? I can run 18 miles, no problem. So I'm like in Florida. I'm going to get with runners. We share common interests. It's going to be amazing. They're going to accept me. They're awesome people because they're not Christians. So I joined a challenge that I'm part of. Every year I run over 1,000 miles. It's a challenge thing. But there's thousands of people there. And one day, right, you know, as I was excited, one day this lady who was very overweight posts, oh, today I ran 35 miles on this machine in like 3 hours. People went crazy. Until this day, I haven't seen 300 comments there. People started joining that chat. You're the biggest liar ever. You're fat and terrible and ugly. People destroying this lady. There's no way that you ran 35 miles in 3 hours. You're such a liar. And they destroyed this lady. I'm thinking, why this poor lady is perhaps asking for support. You know, I and two more perhaps were fighting with everybody else trying to defend this lady. I'm like, why do you care if she's lying? If she ran 3 miles this morning, we're here to support her. And regardless, wherever you look, you will see the brokenness in humanity. You know, inside churches is just a sampler of what's everywhere, right? One day, somebody told me, well, I don't want to be part of church because I'm a you guys are hypocrites. And I told him, well, there's always room for one more, right? So that's just the reality. All of us are messed up. Question is, how do we fix it? And this is with where us humans and this religion comes into play. The word religion is not a bad word. It comes from the Latin religare, which means to reconnect. It's just the attempt of men to reconnect with something or someone. And this is like, right? One attempt to address this is this, right? And it's coming with the understanding that God or the gods are angry. And in order for us to appease the gods or the God, humans have to sacrifice, because we come with the understanding that God or the gods are angry. And by the way, this is a common Christian misunderstanding, which people read the Bible with this lenses, and then they come with a false religion. As a matter of fact, throughout the ages, in whatever culture you look, this understanding of the gods or God who is an angry God is common. You will see it throughout. It is men that have to sacrifice something. It has to hurt. It has to come from us, so that then at the end of our sacrifice, that God is now happy with us again. This is kind of a me-centered approach. This is what false religion looks like. It is me saying, man, if I just do this, if I stop doing that, come on. Misunderstanding in Christianity. This is the fix. I got to keep a day. I got to stop eating this kind of food. I got to stop dressing a certain way. And somehow the God who is angry will become happy with me again. It is me sacrificing. It is I am the center of that theology, not God. And that is false religion. That is unbiblical, and it is against completely the character of God. That is one fix, one attempt. In this religion, their representation is not a cross. It's a ladder. It's us trying to make our ways to heaven. As a matter of fact, I've heard it expressed in different ways. You know, that there's different levels of sanctifying holy. Like the extreme, the bestest, the most impressive holiness that you can achieve is to be a vegan, right? You heard it? I've heard it, right? I pastored a church for some time that was their theology. It was almost that they needed to crucify one of those fake meat things. That was their God, a lettuce, pretty much. It's all they talk about. In that church, that was that. We had worship services, singing towards that lifestyle, preaching that lifestyle, teaching that lifestyle. I'm like, what? False gospel, right? It's a liar. How can I earn? How can I achieve heaven? I love this. This is one of my favorite authors, if you don't know her. Ellen G. White, one of the founders of this denomination, and she says the following. If you would gather together everything that is good and holy and noble and lovely in a man, and then present the subject to the angels of God as acting a part in your salvation of the human soul or in merit, that proposition would be rejected as what? Treason. stuff. But how, we know how we attempt to fix it, but how does God fix it? What does God do? What is his approach? And this is where the most beautiful, bestest news ever come into play. And it's the reality that God uses love to address this. And it is so hard for people to say love. You know, somebody told me one time in a different country where I was preaching about love, and he spit at my face outside as I was going out. And he told me, you're watering down the gospel. And then he spit at my face. By preaching love, you're watering down the gospel. People that resist love are people that are hurting. As a matter of fact, the next day, the board of elders of that church sat down with that man because that man, who was also an elder of that church, was cheating or attempting, sorry, to cheat on his wife by making sexual attempts to the wife of another elder. And he told me that I was watering down the gospel. See, people talk about, resist, emphasize what they're dealing with. See, that's what happened. Love is God's method, man. And love is the most incredible things, powerful theme in the Bible, because we all need it. I'll never forget, I met this young lady. Man, she told me all her story, how her dad had walked away from her life since she was a little baby. And she was crying when she was telling me this story. And throughout her life, she just felt in love because he never reconnected. He never attempted to reach her. He never sent the birthday card, you know. And she always was with that emptiness in her heart. And she was in pain. And she told me, oh, I have so much pain and I don't know how to deal with it. And then she showed me her scars. Throughout her body, in order for her to deal with her pain, she would cut herself. You know, it was hard for her to understand that she was loved. That even though her earthly father had walked away from her, it was hard for her to understand. It was never, you know, she was never exposed to what love looks like. You know how many of us are hurting? How many of us are bleeding inside because we have not accepted the love of Jesus, the love of God? Oh, but this is the good news. This is the greatest news. In Romans 5:8, the Bible says, but God demonstrates his own what? Love for us in this, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Amen. This is a cool thing about God. We come as we are to him. As a church, it's not our job to change people. It's our job to love people. God's job is to change people. Our job is just to accept and love people just as they are. And it is messy, man. Just think about what it takes to love you. Just ask your wife or your husband or your kids, and they will tell you. We can pretend all we want. We can dress up our mess. We can spray, you know, one of those, what they call them, sprays, you know. We still stink like sin. Because we're sinners in need of grace. That's what we are. Christ died for us. I remember in one of the churches I pastored, there was this guy that would come, you know, and he was antsy. Church moving around. You know, every now and then he had to go outside, and out right outside the church he started smoking, and then he would, you know, smoke a little bit and then run back inside. And people started coming to me and telling, Pastor, how could you allow people to smoke? And would tell people, have you talked to him? Have you gotten to meet who they are? Have you heard his story? No, because it says that, you know, it's cancer and then it's smoking. It's like saying that you're a nurse and you don't want to see blood. It's like you being the director of a hospital and saying there is no way, we don't allow COVID patients and in the hospitals. No, no, that's why we're there. That's why we exist. And I would tell people, if you would just hear his story, he would tell you that he's coming off incredibly strong drugs. As a matter of fact, I would strongly recommend him to keep on smoking because it will help him coming out of strong drugs. For some time, he probably will need it. But it's a humongous progress when he was shooting heroin to be smoking tobacco. And if you would have heard his story, he would have told you that he was in one of those detoxing places, and they only gave him a break to come to church. You know what broke my heart? It's that one day he disappeared. We looked and looked. The friend I invited him couldn't find him until we found a newspaper report. His roommate in that detoxing house killed him with an iron on his head. The last stop that God gave him for him to hear the gospel was our church. And what were members thinking about? He is smoking. When Jesus Christ, our Savior, died for sinners just like me. And you. That's what the Bible says. This is how God showed his love among us, he says. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love, not that we love God. You see, there's no flowers for us, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. He is the sacrifice. He is the ultimate payment. There is nothing that you can pay. There is nothing that you can do. You understand? The only thing that we could even attempt to do is to love God back. And even that, we can never say with a straight face and say, I love God number one in my life all the time. That's not true. Not even that is true. But God still, even though he knows you best, he loves you most. That's the gospel, right? And this is what it looks like, the gospel. It is men who are angry. It is God who is in love. And it is God who sacrifices himself on the cross for the people that are angry. As a matter of fact, whenever Jesus was on the cross, people were spitting at him. People were insulting him. People were smacking him around, making fun of him. It was the ultimate sacrifice, the only sacrifice that could pay the debt that was owed by humanity. And this is where the most famous text in the Bible, somebody says if the whole Bible was taken away, this is the one text, that would be enough. For God so loved you and me that he gave his one and only Son, so that whenever you believe in him, you will not perish, but you will have what? Everlasting life. That's the gospel. Jesus on that cross, whenever he saw us, just like Raymond was in that pool of blood. You see, Raymond is my brother. And he was in that pool of blood. And he told me, Harold, I thought that I was going to die then. I thought, I don't know how I'm going to make it out. And, he looked around. He couldn't find nobody alive, and he's like, I'm just gonna, he closed his eyes. But what he didn't know is that one person out of his entire company has opened the breach, the most experienced, the oldest of all, their leader, an experienced man of warfare. And one of our neighbors came and he opened the breach, and he went up a hill, and somehow he wasn't safe. grounds. And this man told us the story that whenever he was on that hill, he turned one last time to just say kind of a goodbye glance to the rest of the company. And in a miraculous way, because there was no binoculars or anything, God gave him the vision to see one person moving amongst the corpses down there. And this man said, I cannot leave one of my brothers behind knowing that he is alive. And he recounted the story and he went back again shooting, right? And he made his way all the way down to the valley where my brother was trying to just survive or die. And he went and without stopping to shoot, he somehow grabbed my brother, put him on top of him, and he wouldn't stop shooting, surrounded by over 2,000 men. This man managed to save my brother. It was only those two men and three others that survived that attack. And every time I think of this story, and by the way, my brother already passed. But every time I think of this story, I think of you and I. When Jesus was in heaven, seeing us in the pool of blood of sin, right, suffering, whenever he would see, you know, people dealing with divorce and death and debt and all of that stuff, when he saw hospitals filled with people, jail cells filled with people, you know, people suffering from depression, all of that stuff is like, man, I have to go. I have to go for them. I cannot leave them down there without any hope. You know, and I imagine in heaven every single angel is bowing down and saying, no, I'll go. Perhaps Gabriel said, man, I'll go. What are you talking about? You're God. But Jesus says, no, you guys cannot do. Only I can do the ultimate payment, the ultimate sacrifice. I got to go back and save. And he even calls us friends and brothers and sisters. And I got to go back for them. And the Bible says that Jesus gave his life for you and I on that cross because he couldn't fathom eternity without you and I. Because he loves you. He loves me. He came back so that we could have everlasting life. And that offer is on the table for you, my friend, today. If you have not yet given your life to Jesus Christ, today is a great day to do so. God is calling you and he's telling you, man, I love you. But I'm a sinner. I know. I love you. But I messed up. I know. But I love you. Yeah, but I cannot even obey. I got you. I know. But I love you. No, but it's just that I need to fix this. No. That's the point. You cannot fix anything. I'll fix it for you. Come to me. Messed up. But I smell like alcohol. That's the point. I love you, man. But my mouth is filthy. Doesn't matter. I still love you. I see what others cannot see. Men only see superficial stuff. I see your heart. I love you. But I just cannot. I'm not the religious type. I'm not calling you into no religion. I just want a relationship with you. No, but I don't want to be too organized. It's not about entering organized anything. I'm going to organize your life. Like, I love you. No, but I don't trust because my dad left me and I understand, and that's why I'm telling you, I love you. But no, men have hurt me and I cannot fathom the imagery of a man when it comes to God. I get you. I came to redeem that imagery. I love you. And I'm showing you on that cross that your love, more than you ever thought, dreamed, or realized, I love you. And that's why Jesus died on the cross for you and I. He tells you, hey, I'll take care of that rest. Just give me your heart, and I got the rest. I pray that you make that decision today, whether you're watching from home or you're here this morning. May you follow Jesus Christ, and your life, I promise you, will never be the same. Let me pray for you. Heavenly Father, blessed be your name. Thank you once again for being with us as we continue to wrestle and understanding the gospel. Thank you, because we already know that the kingdom is here because Jesus Christ came. And thank you, Jesus, because not only did you come, but you also died on the cross for each and every one of us. You took my place. You died the death that I deserve so that I could have eternal life. Thank you, Jesus. And I know that perhaps someone here today is wrestling with that question. They also are saying in their minds, in their hearts, I want to follow Jesus. I want to experience the fullness of life that Jesus offers. I pray that you may enter their lives. May you change them for the better. May you continue to be with this church, Father, as we embrace and love our community. For I pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen.
Up to the front, sat down. Everybody stared at him the whole service. And at the end of the service, and he's walking out and everybody's watching him, and an elder approached him and said, you know, maybe next week if you come back, you'll pray a little bit about what you wear. Maybe you'll wear something different. And then next week he came back, same thing, smelly, wearing bad clothes, right up to the front of the church. And the elder talked to him again after church. He said, hey, did you pray about what you should wear to church? He said, yeah, I prayed, but Jesus told me he'd never been to this church, so he never didn't really know. Let's stand for one more song.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. Since I lay my burdens down, glory, glory, hallelujah. Since I lay my burden down.
Sing it, church.
Glory, glory,
oh, glory, glory.
Hallelujah.
Oh, hallelujah.
Since I lay,
oh, since I lay,
my burdens down,
my burden down.
Glory, glory, hallelujah. Since I lay, I lay my burdens down.
like shadows.